Son and the Holy Spirit, one God. Amen.
It's crazy to think that we're actually a little over halfway done coming to Great Friday and the crucifixion. It's this week flies by. And I think that's the reason why the church today specifically focuses on, it's the day of parables. And specifically, I think there's an underlying theme that I want to touch up on. So I think we're going to touch on the theme really quick, and then we're going to go into two questions that we need to reflect on. So I think the theme is this great wedding, this great banquet that our Lord Jesus Christ is preparing, and how prepared we should be to this banquet. Does anyone remember what the first gospel of tonight was about? First gospel? All right, well, first gospel was about a father, a king, and he had a wedding for his son. A king that had a wedding for his son, and it shows how the God is our father, because he has this wedding for his son, and he's inviting everyone to the wedding. Or actually, initially, he started off by inviting just a few specific people, and the gospel tells us that he sent out the servants to go to these people and invite them to the wedding. Come to the wedding, it's time for it. But unfortunately, these people all came up with different excuses. So some of them were too busy, some of them didn't want to, some of them were too lazy. They had other important things to do, and they didn't really care enough to join this incredible wedding. And I think that really speaks a lot to our day and age right now, is this idea of having too many important things happening in life to focus on what truly matters, to focus on this great wedding. And that's when people, when the father, when the king decided that, okay, these people, okay, forget about them. I'm not going to go out and beg them to come, leave them be. Go out now and invite everyone else. The wedding is going to be open now for everyone. All invites, all are welcome. Everyone is welcome to come and to join this banquet. Let's fill it all up with people. And the servants go out and invite everyone that they see. And it's an open invitation. And the wedding is now full of people that are really willing, that really, really want to be there. And then, kind of like a small side story that takes place, is this idea of the wedding garments, of the wedding dresses. And the father, the king, is kind of walking around the wedding, and he sees this man that doesn't have his wedding garments on, but everyone else does, except for this one person. And it made me think to start with, okay, how did everyone else get their wedding garments? I don't think they had a Woodfield Mall in the way to pass by, or a Target. Can anyone think why they would have, where would they have gotten these wedding garments from? Anything? From the king. Right at the door, they gave them these garments. And they put on the garments and they walked in. So all that these people really needed to do is just be willing to be there. Be willing to go and attend this great wedding with the king. So this one person decided that he doesn't want this garment. He doesn't want this great wedding gown that the king brought for him. And the king goes up to him and he goes, why don't you have your garment on? How can you be at a wedding and not dressed up like this? And, you know, might be for so many different reasons. It might be that he was really comfortable in his hoodie that he had on, or he might just had really fancy clothes on that he didn't want to take off, and didn't have it to get ruined. And I think it kind of goes back to this whole idea of laziness, this whole idea of not wanting to work for it, not wanting to, everything is provided, but we just, sometimes we don't want to push ourselves that extra step. So that was the first gospel. The gospel of the sixth hour also hits kind of on the same theme, kind of just takes it a step forward. Does anyone know which one was the sixth hour? Hint, we read it Egbeia a lot. the 10 virgins. Thank you, Yusuf. The 10 virgins, the parable of the 10 virgins, the 5 wise and 5 foolish. But this time, instead of God being the king and we're invited to the wedding, it takes it a little step further. Now, the bridegroom himself is Christ, and he's there, and this is his wedding. It's his wedding. And these 10 virgins could be looked at as, obviously as us, but as the bride waiting for the groom to come. And this one, I think, hits home a lot closer than the first one, because this one, the virgins are already inside the house. There are people that are here that attend church, that come regularly, that are serving in the church, all of these things. There are people that are here. But for some reason, only about half of them make it, and the other half get casted out, and we'll try to understand why. So I want us, while we're talking about this, to reflect on how the bride, those virgins, are us individually. And if we are this bride, if we're this bride, then, and this is our wedding, the preparation that has to go beforehand is unbelievable. So my own cousin is getting married in September, and we're suffering so much. Not suffering, shouldn't say that. This recorded. There's so much preparation and planning taking place beforehand, a full year of the smallest little detail, from like the flowers to the dresses to the hair to the banquet hall, all of these things. So many little details that take place for just one night. Now imagine how much more this everlasting wedding that will be forever, how much preparation we should do beforehand. But we get to this wedding, and 5 of the virgins don't have enough oil to stay. They have to go out and to buy more. And so those were called the foolish virgins, and then the 5 wise were prepared. I want us to reflect on what this oil could be. And there's a lot of different reflections, but one reflection that I really enjoyed is that this oil is our spiritual struggle. Okay, do you guys know what that means? Our spiritual struggle of our own struggle to become closer to Christ. And the lack of oil is the lack of spiritual struggle. And again, it kind of goes back to this whole idea of laziness, of not wanting to put in the effort, of not being wanting to put in the work, of just showing up to the wedding and not really being prepared. And it's always this idea of, okay, you know, did you read your Bible today? I'll read it tonight before I go to bed. And that kind of comes into tomorrow. Same with prayer, same with fasting, same with confession. And I was trying to do some quick facts while preparing. And in order to read, for example, let's say, reading the whole Bible, cover to cover, reading the whole Bible takes approximately 80 hours. Okay, 80 hours or so. And if we look at how many hours there are in a year, you know, 365 days, 24 hours, that's 8,760 hours that we have in the entire year. Okay? So if we're supposed to tithe that and give 10% to Christ, that's 876 hours. So if we take 10% of that, we have about 87 hours. So reading the whole Bible, technically, is giving less than 1% of your time in a year to Christ. And that would cover reading the Bible cover to cover. Some comparison, that's it takes more time to binge watch Friends, all episodes, takes more time to do that than to read the full Bible. If you would do a round trip, road trip from New York to LA and back, that takes more time than reading the Bible cover to cover. But it's all things that we could kind of, that we do, and we still haven't really covered the full Bible. So it's this idea of struggle, of wanting to put in the effort, of wanting to show the love. Wanting to show the love. And I think that's the theme for this week, is that Christ shows us his incredible message of love. of every beating, every, you know, whiplash, every nail, shows that love. Are we prepared to also do the same? So then looking at this whole wedding theme and being prepared for it, there are some questions that come to mind. Of course, first one is, okay, when is this going to happen? When is the wedding? And I think the gospel of the third hour today tells us that nobody knows. So that one is easy. Sorry, I can't help you. But I think a more important question, a much, much more important question is, if Christ comes today to me personally and tells me, okay, it's wedding time, am I going to be prepared or not? And I'll tell you when he comes to each one of us personally what he doesn't want to find. He doesn't want to find the fig tree from yesterday. He doesn't want to find that. He doesn't want to find, you know, approaching, like, imagine Christ approaching this tree and it looks so beautiful from, like, far away, and he comes to it, no fruit. It's useless. He doesn't want that dead fruit. When he approaches, he doesn't want something like what the Pharisees talked about of washing up and being clean and having, you know, all of this vestment, all of these, you know, plates and all of these things so washed and clean from the outside, but on the inside they're really filthy. He doesn't want a pretty outside and nothing on the inside. And if we're ready for this wedding and he comes to us and he asks us that question, if we're prepared for the wedding or not, I really wonder if when he comes and approaches each one of us, if he'll look at us like the fig tree and tells us, I don't know you, you're not coming to this wedding, or if he'll look at us with a lot of joy. When I was preparing for this, I remember that exactly a year ago was the Palm Sunday bombing in Egypt that the church offered a lot of her children to Christ through that. And this idea of the wedding kind of hit a little bit stronger of, how much willing are we to be prepared? Are we willing to... just like, you know, that idea seems far away that the wedding is coming, but a year ago it was there. So are we willing to die for Christ? Are we willing to sacrifice ourselves? Are we willing to even sacrifice our own comfort? Our comfort zones where we're happy? Are we able to sacrifice a little bit of that to make someone else happier? Are we ready to add in some extra prayers, some zeal in our prayers? Are we ready to struggle in purity? Is that something that we're ready to do, to kind of go against the current of the world and to put our purity as a high priority? Are we able to kind of add in a little bit extra this week with a little bit of fasting or a little bit of ascetic life through Matanyas or anything along those lines that we're able to get us closer? St. Paul says something really weird about this, and he goes, a bunch of verses, but the ones that are coming to mind are, I die daily. I die daily. And then in another place he says, I'm crucified with Christ. It's no longer that I live, but he lives in me. And you kind of wonder how, St. Paul, how can you say that you die daily? How can you be crucified with Christ? And I think it's this idea of dying to our comfort, our need, to our pleasures, to our opinion. You know, if someone doesn't take my opinion, that's me dying daily. If someone doesn't, you know, does something to comfort themselves more than, and it kind of pushes me out of my comfort zone, that's me dying daily. All of those are little signs of love. It's this idea of being willing to be broken down, for Christ to kind of work. Again, the outside doesn't really matter, it's the inside. So I think that kind of covers the first question of, when Christ approaches me for the wedding, am I going to be prepared or not? I think the second one is harder to answer. The second question is, why does it have to be so hard? Why does it have to be suffering? Why does it have to be pain? Why does it have to be all of these things? Why can't our church just be a lot more relaxed about all of this stuff than it is? You know, why, from the gospel yesterday, why is the road so narrow? Why is it so small? Why is there so much struggle? And I think this question, the key to it is in one, practically in one idea, in one mentality of looking through different lenses, looking through different lenses. If we look, again, I think it was the third hour gospel that mentioned the story of Noah. If we look at the story of Noah and we kind of try to put ourselves with the people that Noah lived with, not now, we're back with them. We see this foolish guy spending dozens of years building this huge ark, wasting all of his money, all of his efforts. He's not working on anything else. It's so foolish. What is he doing? What is he doing? Why is he trying so hard? Why is he struggling so hard? Why is he focusing all of his effort for him and his family on this one thing that doesn't make any sense whatsoever? But if we look at it from the lenses of today, and I think if the people that lived with him looked at it from the lenses of today, they would have all been working on it with him. Because they know that the flood is coming. They know that destruction is coming. They know that there's a wedding date coming. And if they're not ready for it, the door gets shut. And I think it's the same exact idea with the cross. We could look at it as... we could look at it as injustice. We could look at it as injustice. It's not fair that Christ be put up on it. We could look at it as suffering. We could look at it as death, as pain. Or we could look at it as the road, the ark that takes us to resurrection, the ark that takes us to salvation, to eternal life with Christ. Yes, it is hard. It's not easy. The ark building was really difficult too. There's a lot of struggle, but the reward afterwards is endless. So kind of to wrap things up, I want each one of us to reflect on what we could do more to prepare. Wedding, like Abuna was saying yesterday, there's a truth. The wedding is coming. Wedding is coming. When, we don't know, but it's coming and it's open for everyone. It's an open invite. And each one of us must be ready. Because if we're not, then that's it. Nobody could intercede for you. No one could come into play for you. If you're not prepared on your own, time is up. We have to have this fruit ready, this struggle, continuous struggle going. I think a lot of the church fathers look at the spiritual struggle idea as a hill made of sand. Or for our cases, it could probably be snow and ice. And we're trying to climb this hill, but it's really, really slippery. And we might fall, and we might take a few steps back, and even some falls might bring us all the way to the bottom again. But the whole idea of the struggle is you struggle to climb. You keep going, and you keep going, and you keep going, and get back up. And you don't get lazy about, okay, you know, I'm fine being here at the bottom of this hill. No, I want to get to this wedding, and I have to continue to struggle. And if there's any time to do that, it's this week. You know, each one of us have our lovely sins that we love so much and we keep dear and close to us, and this is a really good time to push that aside. It's a really good time to add in a lot of good, add in a lot of, whether it's charity work or donations or our own personal spiritual struggles. It's a good time to where, if I haven't confessed in a while, no better time out of the whole year to do that. So I really want you guys to find out where you need to prepare, what kind of needs to go away, and what kind of needs to be added in. And our one hope is that Christ is going to help us through that, wrapping up to Good Friday. Glory be to God forever. Amen.